I am really excited to be here today with the wonderful Rowdy, Roddy Piper. Roddy, thank you so much for being with us today. And we're here actually in front of the New Beverly Cinema in Los Angeles, where I see your name up on the marquee. That's a pretty amazing thing. Tell us what's going on here today.
Well, actually, I've heard this is Quentin Tarantino's theater, and he's a big wrestling fan.
Oh, okay.
And he asks my daughter all the time how I'm doing. So, okay. Quentin, I'm doing fine.
There you have it.
You know, it's a screening of They Live, and it was something that a wonderful promoter here in town, Bill Philput, put together, and he just put it together at the last minute, and I'm astounded by how many people, like, they're turning people away.
Isn't that crazy? Yeah.
Yeah, and it's just wonderful.
I mean, you know? The line earlier, Roddy, the line went all around the block here. 200-plus people, sold-out show.
Do you think I owe money, or is it, you know, from past Dewey's, or what do you think?
It might be, man, but at the end of the day, I mean, to see people out here showing love, wearing the Hot Rod shirt, just representing the love, I mean, that must be a wonderful thing to see so many fans out here today.
You know, it's unbelievable. Let me tell you the most charismatic thing. I've been in an autograph line where they've had five generations, and they shake and they cry, and it's not me. I just happen to be what they're watching.
Yeah.
It's the bonding from them, and you can't buy that.
Wow.
I just got a call from Madison Square Garden, and out of the last 137 years, the garden's been open, and they're picking the top 20 moments, and my wrestling boots now are encased in Madison Square Garden, and now I'm with Quentin in his theater. I tell you, man, you know, I'm just, don't run out of bubble gum, I'm going to be in good shape.
You are on top of the world. Now, I'm going to give you a hug. You're such a nice guy, man.
Starting a rod pod.
Let's talk about that, the rod pod. So, of course, you're in the 21st century, Rowdy Roddy, getting on the podcast thing, and what can fans out there expect to hear you pontificating about on the rod pod?
Oh man, you know, every time you think you got all the questions, I won't change the answers. You know, and the rod pod's going to be free for talk about anything and everything, you know.
So Roddy, is it going to be like a 21st century version of Piper's Pit? I mean, a little controversy, a little bit of some stuff there?
Yeah, you know, I like to be a gentleman, but I'll state my opinion real strong, and it's going to be coming out of Universal. So it's first class. I'm really excited about it. And then I'm going to do another movie, too. Maybe a sitcom.
Really?
Yeah,
wonderful.
With Clark Duke. So it's really cool.
Okay. Well, Roddy, I, as a huge fan of 80s wrestling, WWF, and Vince McMahon can bleep that out, or World Wildlife Foundation can sue me and bleep that out there, but I always say WWF. I'm sorry, that's what I grew up with.
Yeah.
And I mean, I grew up with, you know, Hulk Hogan rockin' wrestling, where, you know, you were a cartoon character. I mean, you were larger than life when you came up against Mr. T. I mean, so many just amazing moments back then. What are some of the things that really stand out in your mind as kind of the highlights, particularly of the 80s era?
Well, the very first WrestleMania is hard to beat.
Okay.
Because there was no battle plan, no nothing, no handbook.
Okay.
You know, it was free form.
Yeah.
The second one probably was the largest indoor crowd in the history of America, I think, till this day, 93,000 at the Pontiac Silverdome.
Yeah.
When the cart came back to get me, something went wrong, and Vince McMahon was standing next to me and says, "Wait, Hot Rod." I said, "Man, if I can't run to that ring, I shouldn't even be there." And I started running.
Oh, really?
93,000 people stood up, and the Gorilla Monsoon and Jesse Ventura, the ex-gov, they couldn't hear each other right from ringside and saying, unbelievable.
The roar of the crowd was just deafening.
Unbelievable love. Well, now I'm in 150 countries.
Wow.
And it's wonderful. I love you all, you know. I'm not that mad anymore either.
Okay.
I don't cause that much trouble anymore, you know. I'm a dad.
Okay.
And but every once in a while, you know, I may be out of step every once in a while, but I ain't forgot how to dance.
Exactly. Well, I'll be careful to, you know, not mince words with you, Roddy. Well, I wanted to talk a little bit. Of course, we're here, as you said earlier, at the New Beverly for a screening of They Live, a movie that has just lived on. I mean, its cult status has just, it's amazing to see so many young people here loving this movie. And of course, you know, there are there's actually two things in the movie that really stand out that have been sort of glorified and immortalized. One is the fight scene that is just one of the most amazing street fights ever immortalized on film.
Put the glasses on. I'm glad I didn't ask him to borrow money. I'd still be fighting him.
and I had read, Roddy, that John Carpenter allowed for some level of impromptu, some sort of off the cuff, given that, you know, the athleticism that you had and other people in the film, he really let you kind of run with that. So to what extent did you, as an actor, were you able to kind of do some things impromptu style?
Yeah, I tell you, with the fight in They Live that makes it special is it matches the arc of the script because the fight was between two friends. And John Carpenter had me watch The Quiet Man with John Wayne, Maureen O'Hara, and at that time that was the longest fight. Here's the best part for me, is when they're fighting, I take a 2x4 and swing it at Keith David, and I miss him and I break the glass, but I realize this is my friend. And I like, oh, but he gets mad while you and bust a wine bottle, but it cuts his hand. And as his friend, that makes me laugh. That enrages him more, and here he comes. So it was a fight between two friends. And then that was made it special.
That's something that a lot of people can relate to, unfortunately. A lot of us, even with people that we love, we sometimes fight with and things like that.
It's part of our nature, you know. We try to get along, but like my wife and I, we've been married 30 years, and we haven't agreed on anything since we said I do.
Okay.
When four of the most beautiful kids in the world.
Yes.
So they,
Wonderful. And then, of course, the famous line that I'm sure you have to say over and over, but and that was something that you just came up with off the cuff, correct?
Yeah. Because so John says action, and he goes hold the roll, which means everything's burning, and he says Rod, he says you're going in a bank, you got bullets on, you got a shotgun, sunglasses, you're not going to rob it, you need to say something, man. You know, I come here to chew bubble gum and kick ass, and I'm all out of bubble gum. Lunch. That was it. And as I'm walking back, I'm going, what did I just say there? What was that? And it was no more than that. I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
And today you see kids walking around with that emblazoned tattoos of that on their arm, that on their shirts. I mean, that your words have are just will live forever. That's amazing.
You know, I just met Shepard Ferry. Really nice man who started an entire clothing line, Obey it's called, Obey from the movie.
Yes.
It's amazing how many things were created from this movie.
And incorporating the likeness of Andre the Giant, of course. Obey Giant was how it kind of started. And speaking of Andre, you know, we've actually had the pleasure of interviewing some other folks from the heyday, in my opinion, of WWF wrestling, the Iron Sheik, Ted DiBiase. Yeah, you don't have to give
it. No.
You don't want the old Roddy to come back, right?
Gotcha.
But Roddy, of course, this last year, one of my, in addition to you, one of my favorite wrestlers of all time, Randy Macho Man Savage, had a very untimely passing. And do you have any memories of that kind of stand out in terms of interacting with Macho Man back in the day? Any matches that kind of stand out in your mind? Or
well, I'll tell you, he did one where I'm not sure I could have done it.
Yeah.
They tied his hands in a rope, and Jake the Snake came out with a real snake and snatched into Randy's arm. And then I, baby Jesus, I think I'll go fight the bear named Victor. I ain't fighting his name.
So but Macho Man truly was macho. I mean, he was able to withstand that.
Macho. I don't know if you can hear this. One time I'm in the dressing room, I'm sitting down, and to my right is Hogan. He's naked, and he's putting on suntan lotion. To my left is Macho. He's naked, and he's got a Norelco razor, and he's shaving his bum. And I'm looking to both sides, and I got a kilt on.
Okay.
That's wrestling. That's God's truth.
I don't know what else to say there, Roddy. Thank you so much for that. And again, check out the Roddy's podcast up on the screen, and check out all the exciting things going on with Roddy. So thanks again, Roddy.
Thank you very much.
God
bless.
Thank you.